him for the introduction, and it's very exciting to host this summer school here and to be giving a talk. So I guess most of you are actually beginning graduate students and might be interested in theoretical physics. And some of you might have a conception that theoretical physics is basically trying to study physics in a smaller scale. And for example, some of you may even heard about string theory as a, for example, the elementary building entity for all the everything we see in the world. But however, actually, a lot of time though, when physicists are actually working, one of the most interesting things people want to study is actually try to understand how, say, a given a physical system, how it actually changes when you evolve this system from a small scale to large scale. And the language physicists usually use to describe this kind of phenomena are usually known as the quantum field theory. And to quote basically the master of quantum field theory, Ken Wilson, who recently died, and he was a Nobel Prize winner around 40 years ago, that basically we can try to classify this kind of evolution from small scale to large scale roughly into three different categories. So the first one is usually like our electromagnetism. So basically we are familiar with Coulomb potential. So when we get further and further, we know Coulomb potential decay with a distance, and it goes like a power law. So the interaction becomes weaker and weaker. So that's the basic first kind of category. That basically we usually call this as something like asymptotically trivial. And the second one, something you might even also heard of, like in a collider, and also you might heard of, we never see any naked quark, basically kind of the elementary interaction between, for example, the quarks is described by QCD. So what happened there? Well, so in the second possibility that you actually have, for example, the potential between different quarks actually go linearly with the distance. So when you pull the two quarks further and further apart, they actually you need to have more and more energy. And when you reach a certain energy threshold, then what do you actually get? Well, you actually have additional particle creation, and those particles are usually known as a meson or baryon. So. And the second possibility that's happening in LHC like on a daily basis, and this is what we normally know as an asymptotically free series. The third one, that's the one we're going to focus on most of today, and tomorrow as well, there's a speaker give a varied aspect of it. It's actually something quite interesting. It's basically happening, you might be happening in study of our phase transition. And in the third possibility, usually what's happening here is that in addition, so for example, you must have studied things like Lorentz symmetries, and you probably, some of you even heard that quantum field theories need to exhibit Lorentz symmetries. Right? You write down Lagrangian, or you basically know Einstein's special relativity, when you try to play with the quantum mechanics, then you immediately go to quantum field theory. But in addition to Lorentz symmetry, which basically happened in the first two cases, that in the third possibility, there's additional symmetries that's known as a conformal symmetries. And that will actually emerge, usually a lot of those conformal symmetries, if you really think about it, as something emerges at the, in a different physical system. And sometimes it can emerge from when you go from the small scale to the large scale. And sometimes actually in the higher dimensional theory, the story goes backwards. But we will not touch the, this higher dimensional theory for most of the lectures tomorrow. But in any cases, the quantum field theory, which exhibit those conformal symmetry, is a topic we're going to talk about today, which is known as the conformal field theory. And the point here is that this is actually ubiquitous. It's everywhere. It's basically like in many of the interesting physical systems, ranging from, for example, in condensed matter, that when we want to study phase transition. And during phase transition, what usually happens is that we study like the correlation lengths that compare with the lattice size. At that point, the correlation length actually becomes so much larger than the lattice size that you basically, when you zoom in, right, when you're looking at the lattice, when you're typically using your instrument, then the physics doesn't actually change when you actually vary your basically the why it's one of the most active topic in the high energy series that in my, some of you might even heard about. I think that holography, and what is holography? What in the earliest, I call it the cleanest incarnation, basically proposed by Moses Sena 20 years ago, which goes by the name of ADS CAT. CAT here is actually a shorthand for conformal field theory. So this is one side, basically one of the probably the most studied quantum field theory in, I think, in the theoretical physics community. And what you will see, I guess, in today, and well, this is actually a vast topic. I mean, and in fact, and sometimes even that, how complicated the things can be depends on the dimension, space-time dimension you are in. So there's no way, for example, in 3 hours worth of a lecture to actually cover everything, what's going on and what's exciting about it, and in fact, connecting to many different aspects, even connected to mathematics as well. This is actually a very active connection between, for example, something known as an integral system, or even a study of a partial differential equation with the conformal field theory. But what you hope to convey, I guess, in the today and tomorrow lecture, what I hope to convey is that first, how this conformal symmetry actually allow us to basically refine our understanding about of physical observables in a quantum field theory, and how, for example, various physical quantities can actually be. Actually, I think today they still in here. Yeah. No. Okay. Yeah. So, for example, in Suning's lecture this afternoon, I guess he will also hope to convey that there's something additional to there's some physical quantity which cannot be, whose value cannot be constrained just by a symmetry or something like kinematic principle alone. But thanks to the recent progress in numerical computing, that we can actually get those dynamical information. That I think we will convey this. And also maybe, I guess, in tomorrow's my lecture towards the end, I will also talk about how some of those things can connect to gravity, which is going to be the second half of this lecture course. So so that's, I think that's where we are going. But before I actually kind of started, that I just want to make sure how many of you have taken a kind of some elementary level of quantum field theory course, so I know the page that should be going under there. Can you raise your hand if you have taken elementary quantum? I know NTU faces, so the rest. Okay, so how many of you have not taken any lecture course on the relativity quantum mechanics, like tensor calculus, so group theories, stuff like that? Okay, I'll go very slow. Okay, so I will try to go very, very slow. The point about this this school is really try to give an introduction rather than flaunting how much we know and how much we don't know. So so do stop me, okay? And it's the speed of my delivery, okay? Can you follow me? 就是说，如果说我要用英文这样可以吗？还是用需要用讲的中文吗？ Okay, so let me try to stick with English and try to go with this pace, okay? But I do have a tendency to speed up as things go along, but if anyone wants to have any question and want to stop me, then please do so. Okay, just shout. Okay, don't just raise your hand there, because I'm going to have my back. So, okay, so in that case, okay, very good. So in that case, in order to try to get everyone on the same page, so I will try to, so let me just write down some conformal field theory. So CAT here would stand for, okay, I write it now. Is my handwriting okay? I mean, big enough? Okay, very good. So, and I guess you don't actually have to copy anything. Okay, all these things are very standard material, and you can find in the many of the very good lecture notes available on the internet. But most of the lecture today and tomorrow, I'll I'll be using the lecture notes by Slava Rajkov. And if you just Google basically like conformal field theory, but it's basically a set of lecture notes publicly available. Let me kick off with something even more basic than conformal standard theorem and so on. So maybe let's try to quickly review, or at least initiate you, to how symmetry principles actually act as they behave in the quantum field theory. So usually when we start with the quantum field theory, so I'm just going to toss the words, unfortunately, some of you may have. You can just think about like everything here, everything today, I think until toward the very end, is going to be classical analysis, so you don't even need to think about quantum. So we usually, starting with, some degrees of freedom, and then you call it a quantum field. These guys can, for example, be scalar fields, or it can be, for example, fermions. How they are classified depends on how they transform under different representation under Lorentz groups. So that's a usual entity. And then we want to, for example, study basically each of them you can imagine and describe some particles. So when we want to think about how symmetry acts, so there are very, very different symmetries in quantum field theory. Sometimes what we call a global symmetry, or sometimes what we call the internal symmetry, that with the symmetry does not act on the space-time coordinate. So each of those x. So right now, okay. So the x. So people are familiar with the Lorentz indices, I hope. Okay. I mean, basically all the Einstein notation, summation, all that. Okay. So mu here will run from. Let me just be a bit more specific. Mu here will run from 1 all the way to d. So we're looking at the d space-time dimension. And we'll be working mostly in the Euclidean signature. So we'll consider basically the rotating the time direction. All of you have some knowledge of special relativity, right? I hope. That's the minimum I can go. So, okay, but today we'll be talking about the symmetry which act on actually the space-time coordinate. Right? So all these things are local field. It depends on basically the space-time coordinates. So think about, for example, today if we could have basically some symmetries which or we can now think about some transformation. Actually, before the symmetry, we can think about, let's say, if we just transform our space-time coordinate, it could be, for example, rotation, and it could be scaling, and it could also be, for example, reflection, and so on. So basically, some action, right, some transformation acting on our space-time coordinate, so we map to a new, for example, space-time coordinate. And as we described, just now that this can depend on what your way of original coordinates are. Right. And the question is that, okay, how does this change of the space-time coordinate act on the those quantum fields that you are having in the system? Right? So for example, then we can have we can start with something very, very general. I would just say, okay, well they're gonna change somehow. Right? And so for example, they can change some of the different functions. So the phi x here, you can even if you are not, you haven't taken any quantum field theory code, just think about, okay, there's some functions, and they are function of x's. And now when x changes, naturally the function itself also changes. And then when you write, I mean, more specifically is that when you try to rewrite it in the new coordinate x prime, then this new function naturally would be different. And another way to really think about it is that you can think about, basically in a space of the field, you can think about all this as phi, a set of vectors, okay? And now, basically, this is vector whose direction, which way is pointing in the field space, depends on the value of x. So when the x changes, then the direction of the field actually also changes. So, but we can express it if the change is continuous. So right now we are talking about some continuous symmetry. So I just slightly stress on this. It's basically like, for example, in your rotation, you can always go all the way back to origin. Or for example, when you do the scaling, you can always change the original size. This kind of continuous symmetry. That, and for those continuous symmetry, we can try to express basically the quantum field after this space-time transformation as a function of its original original value, if you want. Okay, so this is a very general as you can get when you think about the space-time symmetry, including very different possibilities. We're going to talk about something more familiar momentarily. Okay, so, and in order to discuss, so this is basically, right now, this is just basically a transformation. You can think about this as just a space time. Okay, and we just write down how the things act, and precisely how they act, just in case you know something about the group theory, then how this kind of things act really depends on the representation. Symmetry group, usually you know G, so the G here will act on, basically act on the space-time coordinate as well. Okay, so for example, for those of you who have been around here, took our quantum field theory course, you should know how the scalar fermion effect actually get classified under the Lorentz group. That's the G here. Okay, so, right, so really to talk about whether this transformation, this kind of transformation, is actually a symmetry transformation of our series. And we want to discuss this classically for the time being. Then our usual starting point is that we think about if our theory has a, there's a one black hole, but two black holes, but one can be visible. I try not to go to hidden sectors. Okay. So, okay. So, to discuss about symmetries, so all basically is this transformation. Purely classical discussion. Will you just think about it for a moment? Okay, just like when you're classical, in your classical mechanic, that you think about Lagrangian, and next thing you should think about is a variational principle. And there's always a Lagrangian equation in the algebra. So this will be, again, will be a function now, basically a function of a function of those phi. It depends on the those phi x. So there could be multiple number of them. So today you can even give them some labels, I running from 1 to how many on the field we want to have. And so we also make an assumption that this would depend on the derivative, the space-time derivative of the with respect of the quantum field itself. So it depends on those two different otherwise independent variables. You can think about it just like when you write on the Lagrangian. If you think about it, right, it really depends on both the x dot. Well, basically it depends on your x and your x dot as well. And if you promote the time coordinate to the full space time, then there's something you would actually write down. And so, again, so like what we were saying earlier, that once you're given the Lagrangian, or actually in the case of quantum field theory, to be more precise, this is actually what we usually call as a Lagrangian density. So the main difference is just that instead of integrating or your Lagrangian, what you write down, next thing what you write down is the action. Right, in your previous training of classical mechanics, you will write down basically you only integrate over the time coordinate. But now you basically will integrate over the full d-dimensional space-time. Much about the variation of principle, but all these things can be looked up. So basically, you can get avoid that. This transformation we wrote down. So basically, when you do the math, so I'm going to skip quite a bit of the detail here, but well, I'm happy to work it out if you want to stop me or maybe in a break. Now, when you consider this space-time coordinate changes and the action on the field, then basically this action, so this is basically the action, it's going to change into the following. You can just think about, well, it's like a culture prediction. Another way to really think about what's going on here is that you are really just like when you're doing the calculus, that you are changing the variables, the integration variable and so on. Now the integration variable is x, then you go from x to x1. And we also have to change the function themselves. And now the function, we know how it changes. You basically change from phi x to f of phi. And also it's derivative. But when you write down derivative, the key point here is that now the derivative here also depends on the space-time coordinate. So now since the space-time coordinate changes, we also need to add a chain rule. Okay, and this is a Jacobian. We can do the change of integration variables, but now it's just a multi-dimensional thing. So you have a matrices and you can determine it. So. Okay, so here comes the punchline. The punchline is that if this space-time transformation is actually the symmetries of our theory, classically, then basically the symmetry, if this transformation is a symmetry, then this will imply that basically the S, the original action, is exactly the same as the changed action S prime. Well, basically, another way to put it is that you can think about, later you can think about this change as being very, very, very small. Right? For example, this symmetry here can also be just a translation, right? You move your coordinate by a little bit. And this is a very small step, and then you imagine that your action will only also change very, very little. But if this thing is actually this translation, if this if our action, original action, this exhibit this translation of symmetry, then the small changes should vanish. This small change of action should actually vanish. And you can just keep moving a little bit more. And this actually become, right, this is what we actually define at least classically as a symmetry of our theory. Okay, so give a quick example. Now we basically consider, well, you do a Lorentz rotation on your space-time coordinate, and basically your field itself also changes. But precisely how the field actually changes will really depend on. Okay, so here is some prior knowledge to require to be useful here. It really depends on, so this is basically the Lorentz generator. Precisely how this, you can think about this as like some kind of matrix. Well, okay. You did your quantum mechanics, right? So you have a spin, you know, spin half and spin down. And how do you think about the fermion, you know, spin half and spin down? So you think about this as a two-dimensional vector and the Pauli matrices acting on. So, and you can basically, well, okay, so this may not be the best analogy. But anyway, so what I'm trying to say is that you can think about, okay, in the case of scalar, it's basically basically trivial, the action here, basically. Scalar, by definition, is invariant on the action of a Lorentz transformation. But for other different fields, for example, like fermion and vector, you should really think about it as the fermion and vector are basically like vectors. Yeah, you express them in the multiple components. So for example, the vectors here in our four space-time dimension, there will be four different components. And when we consider the action of the Lorentz symmetry transformation on the vectors, then you are basically doing a matrix multiplication. And when you multiply a four-component vector, then this guy should be a 4x4 matrices and so on. And precisely what kind of matrices you are using here would depend on what kind of representation of the field under your Lorentz group. Or in other words, basically which kind of field you have. Okay, that's basically something you should if you are not familiar with this, then I guess you probably won't get too much out of it in the next couple of days. But so I'm trying to at least instill some of the language. Okay, but anyway, so this is basically how the special case, how this Lorentz transformation acting on space time coordinate in the field. And now if we want to see if this is actually a Lorentz transformation is actually a symmetry of our action. So first thing we notice is that, so we basically want to compute. So we now know how all this x prime x are. So we basically just compute various things. So the first one, we know that Jacobian, yeah, is actually just going to be 1. And so basically, now the S prime is actually just PDX and L.